Hello all, welcome to this session on Web Services Security. This is the part of the VTU eShikshana program provided by the VTU platform. Let me now start sharing the screen for the PowerPoint presentation. I hope this is visible to all of you there. Okay. This is the cryptography, network security, and cyber law session 17 CS 61. I am Dr. Padmashriti, who will be guiding you through the module 4 of this cryptography, network security, and cyber law course. As a part of module 4, we have already covered wireless LAN security. We have covered viruses, worms, and other malware. We have also covered firewalls and IDSs. Today, what we are going to do is web service security. The motivation behind web service security, technologies for web services security only in detail, SAML, and other standards that are available to provide web services. There is references book that is prescribed by the VTU is Cryptography, Network Security, and Cyber Law by Bernard Menz, which is a part of the Cengage Learning 2010 edition. The module 4 of this chapter is the chapter 25. For both content creation and delivery, I've been using this textbook because this is the VTU prescribed textbook. So till now, what have we covered? We now know intrusion prevention and detection. We now also know prevention versus detection. We can now clearly differentiate between the two terms. What are the different types of IDS that are available? How do we incorporate each of these IDS for a different application? We've also learned DDoS attack prevention and DDoS attack detection. Today, we are going to start off with a new chapter. That is chapter 25 of your textbook. That is web service security. As told you earlier, I'll be covering the motivation, the technologies for web services. Under this, we are going to specifically learn about four different technologies: XML, SOAP, SOAP, WSDL, and UDDI. Under web service security, we will learn what are token types, how do we encrypt XML documents, and what is special about XML signature. Under SAML, we will talk about assertion types, how to create and communicate assertions, what are the other standards other than SML that are available. Let us begin our chapter with motivation. All of us know that the emergence of web was around early 1990s, that is around 1993. So the emergence of web changed the way human beings started living their life. Millions of users changed the way in which they were shopping, in which they were doing banking, the way they were paying their bills for their utilities, etc. That is because web was available 24/7. Round the clock, web was available. There were many different applications that could be used to cover the household activities, pay bills, bank, do banking, do shopping, all the time in the world. It also gave a personalized experience to each user who is a part of the web. The technology that involved in creating the web involved Java servlets, JSP, ASP. All these worked very well on the Microsoft platform. Microsoft platform exploited the features of the Java and provided scalability and reusability along with the support for transaction processing, security, etc. The next generation was the component-based web technologies, something like the J2EE and the .NET. This securing the communication link between the user and the application was possible by making use of SSL protocol, which we've already studied in one of the chapters. Secure Socket Layer Protocol. Right? Human-to-computer interaction was very well defined in the web applications. Even for the supply chain management, web applications were being used now. It was not only a one-way application, it involved two-way applications. Right? User could interact with the application, application would respond back with a reply. Supply chain management works in a different way than the usual application that involves human to computer interaction. How are they different? The supply chain management is different from the traditional web application in several different ways. One of them is that programs communicate with each other over the web and there is no human interaction, mostly in the SCM. Services will be composite in nature, and such composite services will involve multiple providers, and each of these providers are called as atomic services. There are a large number of such atomic services who provide a given service. So the clients have the freedom and flexibility to change these atomic service providers. Clients and providers will run the application using many different web technology on many different platforms. We say diverse platforms. These diverse platforms can consist of many different types of operating systems, and interoperability will thus become a very important issue for the development of web. Now, all these, when I'm talking to you about SCM or component-based or secure circuit layer, we can think of a web-based travel planning application wherein you want to go on a trip to some place. You would log into a portal, authenticate yourself, right? Authenticate yourself. You will be able to contact a travel agent who can book an airline ticket for you. You can also be able to contact a hotel to reserve a room for you. You can also be able to contact a rental agency to book a car for you to roam around in the place that you want to go. Now here, in such a situation, we have many different atomic service providers. The travel agent, the airline booking, the hotel, the car rental company, etc. Now for a given destination, the agent site will also offer not just one host or hotel for the host. There could be a chain of hotels that he can offer. He can give a lot of car rental options, not just one option. So based on your need and budget, you can actually book any kind of a trip you want with no human interaction at all in between. And be very self-assured that everything is going to work well. This is how web works. So now what is happening here? In such a situation, there could be many different computing platforms and software that is powering this one single travel application to be very successful. And the common term which is used to identify web application that share some of these features or all of these features is called as a web service. The World Wide Web Consortium, you all know about it. The World Wide Web Consortium, called the W3C, it gives its own definition for web service. The web service can be defined as a software system that can be identified by a uniform resource identifier and whose public interfaces and bindings are described using the XML language. And all these definitions given by XML can be discovered by any other software system that wants to interact with this application. All these systems can interact with the web service in a way that is prescribed by its definition using XML-based message conveyed by internet protocol. All these things happen over our IP network, and that is why this definition using XML-based messages is conveyed over the globe by making use of IP. What are the entities that are involved in such a kind of a web service? These are the entities that are involved. The three main entities are requester, provider, and registry. As you can see here in this picture, which is there in your textbook, the service provider is on the left hand side. This is the service requester, and this is the broker, or what we call as the registry. We'll see what each one of them does. This is the interaction. 1, 2, 3 is the sequence of interaction. Service provider. What happens with providers? These providers, they register, or we say they publish. We use the term publish because they make available all their services into a public registry. The requesters, a client you can think of, wants some service. He's going to look into this registry by querying this registry, and he is going to find a service in this registry that is suitable for him. This process is called as the discover process. When once he finds the available service, he is going to bind that service to his own service provider and invoke that service through his application. So this is a sequence of event that happens with the entities that are involved in a web service. For this entire activity to be enabled, we need technology. What are the technologies that are required for web services? The first and foremost technology that is very much required is the XML. XML is a markup language that uses tags. So these tags will identify structures in a document, or to specify a certain presentation style or a format. XML document consists of elements, sub-elements, attributes, document type, definition, XML schema, etc. These are all the components of XML documents. We also have SOAP, S-O-A-P, SOAP, Simple Object Access Protocol, which is a framework for exchanging information or exchanging messages. This is a protocol that is going to define one-way transfer of message between any two entities. A SOAP protocol will consist of envelope, header, and body. To get into small details of these elements of XML and SOAP, right? Now, what is a tag? Tags, we have already used it as a part of HTML. They're used to tell the browser how to display the certain content on the web page. XML tags are a little different. They are used to describe the data, the structure of the data it is going to describe. XML does not have any tag set. That is why we call XML as a meta language. You can create your own tag set based on what kind of application you're building, right? In any kind of a field, education field, medicine field, you can build a medical application. For your, to take online classes, you can build an online application. If you're a lawyer, you can build a legal application. Based on this, you can create your own tags. The most basic kind of markup, which is found in any XML document, is called as an element. Now, the start of this element is indicated by a start tag, end of the element is indicated by an end tag. There could be sub-elements inside an element, right? For example, you want to say name, first name and last name could be sub-elements of the element name. You want to say address element, the street, the city, the state, the pin code could be the sub-elements of the address element. An element may contain zero or more attributes. This attribute is a name value pair. Okay, so this is required to be specified in the element name, in the element start tag. Fine. So that is about attributes. Now, what is a document type definition? You would have heard of these short form DTD. That's what it is. A DTD, it's a standardized XML schema. This XML schema contains rules to understand the content of the document. What kind of rules does it have? It is going to tell you if the element type is a decimal, if it is a string, if it is a complex type. How are the sequence of elements nested? What is the content of the element? Does it have any attributes? Is it optional? Is it mandatory? It could be anything, but the DTD is a standardized schema that contains the rules to interpret the document's content. Moving on to SOAP technology. Simple Object Access Protocol was standardized by W3C, which is a framework for exchanging structured information over the internet. Most of the information in the message is in its body. The header of SOAP is used extensively to extend the message, and this includes the security meta information. Security information in the sense it is going to include encryption algorithm used, if there is a digital signature, the MIME type, etc. So message also can contain what we call as RPCs or remote procedure calls. Okay, but these remote procedure calls and so on, you all should remember that it is an XML format. This SOAP message is encapsulated in a HTTP request packet, and it gets a response back encapsulated in a HTTP response packet. A SOAP message between two endpoints can be routed in between intermediaries. It is not point to point, it is in between intermediaries that the message is conveyed from the source to the destination. A node in a SOAP message path will require information about what messages it is going to transfer from one place to another place. The information is conveyed by two attributes in SOAP, that's the role and must understand, that are included in the block. When this header is processed, the node could modify the value, it could remove the header, it could insert a new header. All that is possible and is supported by SOAP. Moving on to technologies, two other technologies, WSDL and UDDI, are very common terms that you would have heard of by now. WSDL is Web Services Definition Language. It's the language for describing web services. The complete WSDL service definition consists of types, messages, operation, port type, bindings, etc. The port type specifies one or more operation within its scope. So what is an operation? Operation is the definition of an action. It could contain one or more messages, it could contain a notification, it could contain a request response system. A message is just a definition of data that is exchanged as a part of the operation. So all these comprise of the WSDL. So what is UDDI? Universal Description, Discovery and Integration is a registry. It is a database or registry, a catalog that allows the businesses across the globe to make themselves public over the internet. Anybody who wants to make use of these business services will look into this registry. They send SOAP messages to this registry, right? To look for a web service. If it is suitable, as we saw in the entity interaction diagram. If it is suitable, it is going to bind it along with ISP and make use of that cells. Now, UDDI can be just thought of as a telephone directory, which consists of white, yellow, green pages, etc., right? Each of these colored code have a different category. Some which stores business information, some which stores personal information, etc. Now, is SSL suitable for a web service? Did we ever think about it? With all these complications that are involved, with lot of data that we are storing, with lot of interactions that is happening all over the world, is SSL suitable for web service? Actually speaking, it is not suitable. Why is it not suitable? Among the many reasons, there are two important reasons that all of us should know. SSL is point-to-point and web services involve many intermediate services also. So it requires end-to-end security, not point-to-point security. The encryption and signing of specific messages is required for web service. End-to-end encryption is required. End-to-end signing is required. Point-to-point service, point-to-point encryption is just not suitable for web services because web services are an integration of many different other services. So now what to do? Is there a solution for this problem? Definitely there is a solution. We make use of WSC, Web Services Security. The Web Services Security is just another technology that makes this work possible. It defines the structure of security token and applies it to the SOAP header. So it gives us the rules, the regulations, and how it can be applied to the SOAP header. What are the main functions of WS Security? The WS Security defines XML elements, which is used to communicate security tokens. It also defines syntax and processing rules to encrypt SOAP messages. It defines syntax and processing rules to create and process digital signature also. Now we all should remember that WS Security involves three things: security tokens, encryption and decryption of SOAP messages, and digital signature. So WS Web Services Security performs functionality to provide all the three, right? All the three. The first version of WS Security was created by OASIS, Organization for the Advancement of Structured Information Standard, in 2004. Inputs for this first version was given by many different companies, among which IBM, Microsoft, and VeriSign played a very important role. The WS Security involved XML encryption. The XML encryption was developed by W3C in 2002. The XML encryption was defined by XML elements for representing encrypted data and keys which are used for encryption. The key attribute of XML encryption is that it allows encryption not just point to point. It allows encryption at different levels of granularity. The encryption could be entire document encryption. The encryption could be a complete XML element within a document. The encryption could also be a content of the XML element. Let's talk a little bit more about XML signatures. The XML signature was developed by the same W3C consortium and IETF in 2002. I hope we all remember IETF is Internet Engineering Task Force. IETF and W3C, they came up with the syntax for the digital signature and signature keys. And they also came up with many different ways of signing the XML documents. Parts of the documents could be signed by an entity. One or more intermediaries where message passes through can attach their signatures to one single document. I mean to say that one single document could have multiple signatures. It also means that two or more entities can sign over the same document, overlapping with one another. Same document could be verified by multiple parties, or disjoint parts of the document could be verified by individual parties. This was the strength of the XML signature. The syntax for the signature keys, and the rich set of options that are provided by W3C and IETF was a huge success. Now, how does all these things work? First of all the documents are converted into canonical form. So once they're converted into a canonical form, they get a serialized representation. A serialized representation gives an overview of how the documents are organized. A hash for each of these documents is computed, and encryption using sign as private key is made possible. So this is the whole process that is involved in signing a certain document. This is better explained using this tree structure. The tree for XML signature element looks something like this. You see, on top of the tree is signature. The signature consists of the signed info, signature value, and key info. The signed info is an element which consists the consists of information about the canonicalization. We have stored it in canonical form. So what canonicalization method is used is specified by signed info. The signature method, right? The signature method and the reference are also a part of the signed info method. Right? A signature in the form of MAC. We have learned about MAC, message authentication code. Even that kind of a signature is supported by this XML. Okay, a single signature is computed over many different multiple elements in the document. Some elements may be in the header and some may be in the body of the SOAP message. Right, so in such a case, references to all these are included within the signed info element itself. That is why we have reference here. The signature value, it contains the digital signature. Now, the signature is nothing but a computation, and this computation is computed on the entire signature element here, the root element. It is computed on entire signature element. So how do they do that? They do that by canonicalizing the signature element using canonicalization algorithm. Then the signature is generated using signature algorithm. Where is the signature algorithm? It is in the signed info. Right? It is in the signed info sub-element. Signature method stores the algorithm. Then the key info is the element that includes the reference to key material, which is needed very much for verifying the signature. At which end, who's going to verify the signature? When you put a signature, it is the receiver who's going to verify the signature if it is right or wrong. Correct? So verification of signature, if it has to happen, key info is required. If there is a reference to X.509 certificate, then that has to be specified here. then that has to be specified, right, in the reference. While verifying the signature, the certificate would be used to verify it. X.509 certificate would be used to verify it. Fine. Next, we'll move on to SAML. So, SAML is a solution for the most common problem that was encountered. Cookies were created by browsers. Cookies were created for browsers. They were created by web service. More than one web server needed to interact with each other. But the capability of the browsers were not allowing these cookies created by one web server to be dispatched into another web server. To solve this important problem, SAML came into existence. There were many different assertion types for SAML. By the way, SAML means Security Assertions Markup Language. Even SAML was given to us by OASIS, which is Organization for Advancement of Structured Information System. And that's a standard which is going to address these problems. It provides XML schema for expressing assertions about a certain principal value. The SAML assertions and their XML syntax, or the assertion types, what we call, are three: authentication statement, attribute statement, authorization statement. Authentication statement is an assertion by the identity provider that it has authenticated a certain entity or a principal C using some authentication method at some point of time. Attribute statement is again an assertion by identity provider saying that a value of a certain attribute for that principal is this, say XYZ. It is going to confirm that the attribute value is this. Authorization again is an assertion by identity provider saying that a certain principal is permitted to perform an action. Action is nothing but an operation on a certain resource. Okay, so he's permitted. That's authorization. You can use this resource. A simple assertion is shown here. Let's see if we can make this. Yes. Okay. This is a simple assertion, SAML assertion. The authentication statement, you can see here. You can see all the three entities that we talked about, assertions, let's call them, not entities, that we talked about just now. You can see an authentication statement. This itself is an authentication statement. You can see attribute statement, authorization statement. Right? This is how an authentication statement looks like. These are all elements. SAML begins with SAML, ends with SAML. Name, ID is an element. Name, ID, SAML, sub-element begins here and ends here. Authentication statement begins with authentication instance, the session index, the information inside the elements you can see here. How do we create and communicate assertions? Creation and communication of assertion is a single sign-on method. This is the most famous application for SAML. Right? A single sign-on. You log into a website using authentication. And based on the personalization of yourself, the web page will get updated, or it is going to render with the right information. selection and navigation to further pages in a web application is made through SAML assertions based on what you are going to select on that page. Let's say you are traveling to Dubai for 10th time in a year. You are a frequent flyer. When you log into their website, let's say Emirates, you are a frequent flyer, you are a golden customer, you have a lot of discount. Once you log in through authentication, based on your credentials, the web page will get updated. It knows what flights you have taken previously. It is going to give you recommendations for the flights. When you select a certain flight and navigate to further pages, based on the rules for you, because you are a frequent flyer, the airline wants to give you a 40% discount. So based on your credential, assertion is based on your selection and is passed to the further pages. Not everybody gets that assertion based on selection. It's only you, because you are a frequent traveler, you get the assertion based on selection. And that is what we talk about: personalization, recommendation system, and all these involves web services. Right? So this is SAML assertion, which I just showed. Other than SAML, there are also other standards. We need to know a little bit about WS Trust, that is Web Services Trust. What is amazing over the web is that the endpoints of web service may never have interacted with each other. Only the intermediate parties that are enabling this interaction between the source and destination will be active throughout, and the user at one end may receive his results even without knowing who the destination is. And all that is the basis of trust. All these intermediate systems that we are talking about, they were used. They were used to create a SAML token. SAML token. Just one SAML token will not be able to provide web services over the globe. There are so many different web services that are over there, out there in the world. A general and powerful framework is required to contain different types of trust. There does not exist just one type of trust, right? There could be different types of trust. So we need a framework that is more powerful and general, which can encompass different types of trust: direct trust, indirect trust, broker trust, intermediary trust, any type of a trust. Besides that, SAML tokens are not the only tokens that are generated over the web. There are so many other tokens that are being generated every now and then, and this framework should support all these tokens. The framework should also be able to define messages for requesting security tokens and validate these tokens which are received from the client. So these are the different standards other than just SAML that are required over a web service environment. If we talk about the big picture of whatever we did in today's session, we discovered the web service security policy, SAML, and WS Trust, which are very important. We also have WS Secure Conversation. Two parties can establish a session context using that. The state of a session, which will include a secret key, they can share for some duration of that session only. The WS Trust builds specially on WS Security. That also we have to remember. WS Federation also exists, which builds on WS Trust. It helps this broker trust. The WS Federation is like a broker. It helps broker trust between entities in different security domains. So there are many different standards which are developed for web services security, and they all complement each other. A single application may use several different standards. Why do they use different standards? Because they want to reach different security goals. And at the same time, many different developers may use different subset of standards to achieve their security goals for the same application. Right? So, web services security is not just about learning a single chapter. Generally, web services security involves a large area of providing security. It is a totally large area of how security is provided over many different enterprise applications. Based on this, we can try to incorporate web security through web services for a different application each time. So that's the end of this module 4. Thank you all for listening. If you have any doubts or questions, please feel free to contact me at padmashriti@rvce.edu.in. Thank you very much for your support. I would like to thank the VTU eShikshana Committee for giving me this opportunity to share my knowledge on cryptography, network security, and cyber law course to all the students who are listening here throughout the state in this time of pandemic. Thank you very much.